நீ கமர சொல்லால் மட்டும் நம்பாதே, சொல்லால் மட்டும் நம்பாதே, சுயமாய் சிந்தித்தே தெளிவாய் வல்லாயுடலில் இயக்கம் அவன் வல்லாயுடலில் இயக்கம் அவன் வாழ்வில் அறிவும் அவன் வல்லாய் உடலில் இயக்கம் அவன் வாழ்வில் உயிரில் அறிவும் அவன் கல்லார் கற்றார் செயல் விளைவார் கல்லார் கற்றார் செயல் விளைவார் காமம் இன்ப துன்பம் அவன் காமம் இன்ப துன்பம் அவன் எல்லாம் வல்ல தெய்வமதி எங்கும் உள்ளது நீக்கமர அவனின் இயக்கம் அணு ஆற்று அவனின் இயக்கம் அணு ஆற்றல் அணுவின் கூட்டு அவனின் இயக்கம் அணு ஆற்றல் அணுவின் கூட்டு பகுவம் நீ உன்னில் தான அவனில் தான அவனில் அவன் யார் நீ யார் பிரிவேது அவன் யார் நீ யார் பிரிவேது தெய்வமது அவனை மறந்தான் நீ சிரியோ அவனை நீ சிரியோ அவனை அவனை அறிந்தால் நீ பெரியோ அவன் நீ ஒன்றாய் அறிந்த இடம் அவன் நீ ஒன்றாய் அறிந்த இடம் அறிந்து அது முக்தி அறிவு முழுமை அது முக்தி எல்லாம் வல்ல தெய்வமது தெய்வமது
Anuradha and also Hemamalini. Can you just introduce before we take a review, Shanti, one by one, okay. 1 minute each.
Vaalga valamudan sir, vaalga valamudan ayya.
Yeah.
Come on the video, yeah. Ma'am.
Come on, yeah. Come on the video and we have with us Dr. Anindranath. Yeah, vaalga valamudan ma. We have been talking and we are very greatly pleased to see you. And shortly, you know, we have been regularly meeting on Tuesday. This is a very special meeting, blessed by our Dr. Ravindranath ji, and regularly we are meeting on Tuesdays at this time, same time. And we have with us Dr. Sharma Velu from Mysore. Of course, our Muthumani is a key for all this, coordinating wonderfully. Always the first attendance will come from Dr. Indra ji from US, and Dr. Vijay Gupta, and of course our regular visitor and wonderful commentator Dr. Swendra ji is also there, and Parameshwaram has joined us in the last couple of weeks. Parameshwaran joined us, so we are here, a small team of around 13 people, and some more people are yet to join. They will join later, like Kamare Selvi and all, Aruna and all. You may shortly introduce yourself. You are doing a great job in our College of Yoga, Maharishi College of Yoga. Go ahead.
Vaazhga Valamudan, vaazhga valamudan to all dignitaries. I'm glad that you have invited me to join in this forum. I'm Shanti, a PhD scholar, doing the research on hypothyroidism in the department Yoga for Human Excellence under Bharathiyar University. I work as the assistant professor in Vedatri Maharishi College of Yoga at Tiruvannamalai. I'm very much interested in this research field, and one of my ambition is to take this Vedatriyam to the international level, to make everybody in this world to know about Vedatriyam. Vaazhga Valamudan, sir. Vaazhga
Valamudan. Thank you, Shanti. Nice. Your wish will be fulfilled, because you know the eminent doctors around here. You will get excellent guidance and counseling, and you will do wonderful in your research paper. And let us now call upon
Anuradha.
Hemamalli sir. Yes, ma.
Vaazhga Valamudan. Come on the screen. Same thing.
Yeah, enna adu.
Ah, pesu.
Vaazhga Valamudan sir.
Vaazhga Valamudan.
Thank you all for eminent persons for giving this opportunity to introduce ourselves before you, sir. I'm Hemamalini from Chennai. I'm doing my PhD in Simplified Kundalini Yoga with the subjects as diabetic patients, sir. So I want all your advices to follow the exact pattern to do it in an effective way, sir.
And now you are appearing.
Diabetic patients, sir. No. Type 2 diabetic patients.
Okay, okay. Which year are you now?
Completion stage, sir.
Completion. Okay,
completion stage. Either pre-test, post-test and all I have completed, sir. I'm in the process of writing the thesis.
Very good. Wish you good luck.
All the best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Right, thank you so much.
Thank you. Now, next,
thank you, sir.
Who is the next scholar? Anuradha, you may... Come on the video.
Vaazhga Valamudan, sir.
All
a very good evening to all of you, sir. I'm very happy to present here in front of great eminent persons and dignitaries. I'm a PhD scholar doing in Bharathiyar University in Vision. And this is my final year. My topic, I'm doing another topic, Simplified Kundalini Yoga on transgenders. So I have completed my data collection. So I'm going to write my thesis. I am very interested in writing research articles, and especially in research part. So I don't know where to start, how to start. So I asked last time in the discussion, I think Shanmugavelu sir's discussion, Rangasamy sir has told that we have the opportunities. So right time we have came here, I think, sir. So
right.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Anyone else? Okay. Yes, Dr. Ravindranath ji, we welcome these new scholars.
Yes.
Now we will get on our first point of a quick review of last week's proceedings.
Yes.
Vaazhga Valamudan, be blessed by the divine. Hearty welcome to all the participants. This short review will help the new participants an insight to their previous topics covered, as well as it will be very useful as a revision for all of us. And last week, Dr. Surendraji was the main speaker on 27th. She gave an excellent presentation on Kayakalpam and its benefits through her deeper study. She emphasized that we should give focus more on Kayakalpa studies in this forum. And she also said our Maharishi's speciality is Kayakalpa. And no other guru has come forward to give us this wonderful treasure for all of us. This was her main emphasis, and she requested us, and she went on to give lots of information, which later was very useful. In fact, that was later summarized by our Dr. Shanmavelu wonderfully well, and he presented by showing some slides. It's always a wonderful collection of he has excellent collection of PPTs, which I am sure this research scholars will definitely benefit from. He also the summary in 2 minutes, actually this entire Dr. Devi's presentation was summarized by him by showing one slide, which shows the Keshari Mudra, Keshari seal, closest top of Sushumna and trapping the Bindu. She was always talking about Bindu and the Siddhas, how they have been doing this Kayakalpa practices and lived for ages and ages. And Jalandhara Bandra, throat lock. He also showed closest the windpipe trapping prana. He further showed a trap prana unblocks the Sushumna, the central channel, awakening the Kundalini. And he also showed that how this Mulabandha, the root lock, closes the lower opening and trapping the prana. These are belonging to, actually, in a nutshell, he has told that these are all belonging to Mahamudra. Simulates all the endocrine glands. Swamiji's simplified Kayakalpa Yoga gives everything through this Mahamudra in Ojas only, according to Dr. Shanmugam's findings. Further, our Mahabalivarajan was called upon by a doctor, and he also said what we should do using this latest technologies of magnoelectron and neuroimaging. And he said it is measurable in blood, and whereupon our Dr. Ravindranath suggested that yes, you must do this measuring of the blood fasting, and whether you use magnetron or this imaging processes. Hormonal study also he touched upon, how the sympathetic and parasympathetic measure to the level is possible, corresponding, correlating with the central effect and the spiritual effect was his main point, which our doctor mentioned. Now, as an assignment, doctor also said that yes, various studies have been so far conducted. The outcome of the processes must be done in a very systematic way. How they found, he also said how these Siddhas have done so much of research, and Siddhas have lived for long by quietly practicing this, and how beautifully this is done. That was Dr. Indraji was called upon at the end. She said it's so very beautifully done, and that India has so much blessings. Very much she was appreciative of the clarity. And while mentioning about this, she said, we have been doing so much on all these forums. Let us do, in a nutshell, she said, perish or publish. This was her word of caution, that we have been not recording this, codifying this, and which we have discussed that we must quickly allocate these scholars to make a presentation of what so far has been given by these so many of the doctors who have been called upon. So with that, let me hand over the mic to Dr. Ravindranath ji. You may go ahead. Thank you.
We'll give it to Dr. Shanmugavelu.
Yes, Dr. Shanmugavelu is ready always with the slides. Beautiful slides are coming. Enjoy. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Be blessed by the divine. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, very much.
Yes.
Voice is a little low.
Okay, that can be done. Improved.
Yes, yes. Now we'll see. Am I okay now?
Yeah, yes. Okay.
Okay, right. I think in the background some sound is coming. I don't know from where it is coming.
Some crackers welcoming your talk.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Crackers are going on in Hosur only, doctor.
Yes.
Appreciating doctor's talk. Okay, carry on.
Yes, sir. Valga Valamudan. Now, today we are going to talk about the science of Kayakalpa. Before entering into the science of Kayakalpa, I wanted to tell one thing, that we are doing always everything on the physical level, but with the awareness from now onwards, we should concentrate more towards the astral body, because whatever happening, it is happening in the astral plane, and most of the time we are not realizing it. Now we are in the physical plane. Be aware and concentrate in the astral plane, then only we can reach the spiritual plane. And today the topic is Kayakalpa. In the Kayakalpa, I have come to the end point where we are using certain techniques by using Ashwini Mudra, Moolabandha, Ojas Prit, and Kesari Mudra. In that, I am going to deal with the Ashwini Mudra and Moolabandha mainly today. So, regarding bandhas, it has been said there are three: Jalandhara Bandha, Udyana Bandha, and Moola Bandha. When all the three are locked, the final bandha is the Mahabandha. So, what they are telling is all these bandhas should be introduced to the people who are in meditative field, should be introduced only in the end. Sir, any problem, sir?
I am clear.
Okay. So what they are telling is it is a secret technology and it should be introduced only in the end. Such is the importance of all these bandhas. Okay. What is bandha means? We know it's a lock, but in the other way, it is a physical lock, but in the astral level, we are opening certain things. It is unlocking goes on at the mental and pranic level in the astral body. That's more important. We are opening into another field of energy. So bandha is not just a lock. We are opening into the other world. That's more important. And bandhas are very powerful. They work at the physical, pranic, mental, psychic and causal level. They are having far-reaching effect. So the bandhas are considered as very dynamic, explosive, with immediate effect. The simple contractions of the muscles in the arms and legs are different, but the contraction in the Ashwini Mudra and Moola Bandha are very powerful. That we should understand and should underline that first. Okay. So as I said, when we contract in Moola Bandha, we are contracting the perineum, but not only it contracts the muscles, it stimulates the parasympathetic system also. But sympathetic system is there, but at a subtle level and subdued level, the dominant energy is from the parasympathetic stimulation.
Doctor, can you increase the volume
a little bit? Volume increase.
Great, sir.
Okay, let us try.
Now, sir.
Okay, now fine.
Now it's okay, no. Right, sir. So, in neuroendocrine path, we are using the hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis known as limbic hypothalamic-pituitary-adrenal axis or hypothalamic-pituitary-adrenal-gonadotropic axis. In this, we are stimulating the, by contracting the moolabandha, that is the levator ionic muscle, that is the pelvic floor, we are stimulating the parasympathetic stimulation that in turn stimulates the hypothalamus, which in turn stimulates the whole limbic systems and the cerebral cortex, the outer layer of the brain. So here in this picture, I want to show the the lowest picture shows the sacral nerve. So when we stimulate, our impulse goes through this nerve to the brain, and from there, through the vagus nerve, it comes out and supplies to the body. That is the pathway of our stimulation in the parasympathetic system. And here, again, you can see in the lowest area, you can see it stimulates testes and ovary, and it works on the penis and the clitoris. So that's more important. When we are working on moolabandham, we are stimulating all the endocrine glands, including the testes and ovary, and it is having an effect on the urinary tract and the vagina. That's more important. Right. So at the same time, the bandha, as I said, it affects the endocrine glands also, and they stimulate. So here, all the endocrine glands I have mentioned, from the hypothalamus, pituitary, pineal, thyroid, parathyroid, thymus, adrenal, kidney, pancreas, ovary, uterus, testes. So almost all the endocrine glands are uniformly stimulated by just the contraction of the moolabandha. I think there is a little trouble with my signal. If anything problem, I have to change my signal. If anything, you please tell me, sir. Okay. Next, we are going to Udyanabandha. Udyanabandha is a contraction of the abdominal muscles. And apart from the brain in the skull, we are having two more brains, that is one in the heart and one in the guts. That will say it's the heart feeling and gut feeling, usually people will say, in Udyanabandha, by contracting the solar plexus, we are squeezing the brain in the stomach also, and the energy is getting distributed all over the body. In Jalandhar Bandha, by stretching the neck and pulling the spinal cord, we are stimulating the parathyroid gland, thyroid gland, and thymus glands. At the same time, we stimulate the parasympathetics in the spinal area of medulla oblongata, which is situated at the bottom of the brain and top of the spinal gland. This regulates the heart rate, respiration, and blood pressure. At the same time, it compresses the carotid sinus, so it controls the sympathetic action and activates the parasympathetic action, so it helps for the relaxation. So in Mahabandha, we are locking all these three bandhas. In that, what we are doing is, by Keshari Mudra, we are blocking the upper end of the Sushumna Nadi. By Jalandhar Bandha, we are blocking our respiratory tract. By Moolabandha, we are locking over the lower Sushumna, and in between the upper and lower end, that is Brahma Dwara and Brahmendra, we are blocking the prana in the Sushumna Nadi. There, through Udyanabandha, when we give extra pressure, it gets pressurized, and because of the Manipuraka Act and because of the pressure, the heat increases and it expands. So the energy increases and multiplies in a lot way. When we release it, It spreads all through the body and gives its spiritual power to the body. So this is the picture why I showed in the right hand side lower picture. You will see in Jalandhar Bandra, when we are contracting the multifidus muscle, that is in the spinal cord, that is spinal column in the vertebra. And in Udyan Bandha, you can see the upper left, we are contracting the transverse abdominis muscles and we are pressing the stomach. In the lower abdomen, when we are locking the Mula Bandha, we all know we are contracting the pelvic floor, the levator ani muscles. So in Mahabandha, the prana is compressed in Sushmana. The lock prevents its downward and upward movements and at the same time stimulates the energy. So release of Bandha flushes prana through the whole body. And yes, prana is by virtual nature, it's a vital, life-giving energy. The body is relaxed, toned and rejuvenated. The grandhis can be then be pierced and united with the expanding consciousness. This is the, but what here I want to tell is, whatever we are doing in Mahabandha, almost we are doing the same in our Ojas breath, in our Kayakalpa exercise. That is why I am having a feeling our Swamiji simplified the Mahabandha for the understanding of the people and for the practical purpose. He used only Aswini Mudra, Mula Bandha and Ojas breath. But while we are using Ojas breath, we are using Kesari Mudra and we are using the Mula Bandha. So it is a combination, a simplified combination given by our Maharishi. This people can discuss afterwards. So when the prana is retained and compressed in the Sushumna Nadi, they produce a type of retention. That feeling of retention first takes place in the muscles, then takes place in the breath, and then in the sense, then in thought, and in the consciousness. So that reaching consciousness is the final position. When we are able to retain our mind in that conscious level, we are almost at the level of awakening the Kundalini. So now let us look at the anatomical and physiological aspects. In the anatomical aspect, we should specifically look at the perineum, perineal body, and the pelvic floor. So the perineum is a group of muscles which extends the entire length of the pelvic floor related to both the urogenital diaphragm and anal areas. It is not a single muscle. Mula Bandha is not the contraction of the whole perineum. We have to contract only part, but when we contract automatically, the Vajra Mudra and Aswini Mudra sets in. Well, let us see how we can avoid this. So when the average person contracts the anal sphincter, the perineum is also involuntarily contracted because of the pudendal nerve. Pudendal nerve is at our conscious level, and when we consciously contract the anus, automatically the whole muscle gets contracted. So realizing this interconnection between the anal sphincters and the perineum, in the beginning for this Mula Bandha, they advised Aswini Mudra first. Thereby, the sadhakas can be trained in the Mula Bandha. So in this picture, you can see on the left side, the upper aspect of the pelvic floor, that is from the aerial view, from above down, if we see, the pudendal nerve supplies the whole area. In the same way, if we look from below upwards, the bottom view of the perineum, again the same pudendal nerve supplies the whole area. This pudendal innervation, which is having a dominant parasympathetic effect, is very important. We should keep in our mind. Okay, now this floor is divided into two groups. Those of the anal, which is around the anal, is one group, and those around the urinary tract and the vagina is another one group. the muscles around the anus are more powerful. So here I want to put the picture for the clarification. The first picture, that is more on the right side, shows the whole pelvic diaphragm. In that we can see the anus, vagina, urethra, urogenital diaphragm, and the levator ani muscles. These are all set up in layers. We are seeing from the lowermost layer. When we remove the fascia of the urogenital diaphragm, you go up and left, you are seeing, we are seeing only the muscles. The muscles in the urogenital diaphragm, the muscles of the levator ani muscle are fully seen. And the lowest on the left side, if you see, there I have removed the urogenital diaphragm and we have gone still up from below, and we are seeing only the levator ani muscle, which is around the anus and around the vaginal opening and around the urethral opening. In this way, we can have a three-layer structure in the pelvic floor. And this is the urogenital diaphragm, the lower area in the female. And this is the urogenital diaphragm in the male, because this urogenital diaphragm is having lot of muscles. Transverse perineal muscles are there, bulbospongiosus, cavernous spongiosus, all these muscles are there, along with it's a compartment with a superior fascia and inferior fascia, and bulbous spongiosus area is in between. So that area, why we are concentrating, means it is the area concerned with the Vajralimutra. And we are going to see what is the importance of Vajralimutra again. So this is the another same aerial view of the pelvis from above, below we are seeing. Here we are seeing the rectum, we are seeing the vagina, and we are seeing the urethra. Here what I want you people to see is, in the rectum, if you concentrate, there is one concentric ring of muscles around the anal canal. So that is the anal canal, sphincter of the anal canal. So this sphincter of the anal canal also connected to the levator ani muscle, and it sends fibers to this area. So as we said, the muscles of the perineum are divided into two groups, but there is a connecting area. That is a fibrous tissue, and are interrelated to the extent that movement of the one group usually elicits the response from the other. So the controlled movement of one area alone requires considerable skill. Now we said, when we contract, the whole perineum gets contracted, but by practice we should be able to contract different areas. But muscles of the perineum are normally used only on the occasions of urination, defecation, ejaculation, and orgasm. Here, what point I want to stress is that floor of the muscle, muscles of the perineum are not at all in our conscious mind. It is always in our unconscious territory, and all the things, the urination, defecation, ejaculation, orgasm, all are taking place on their own. When they are happening, we don't realize that is happening through the pelvic floor. Now, when we are doing all these things, we should keep our concentration on the pelvic floor, and you see, when we are passing the urine, only the front part works. And during defecation, only the anal part works. During orgasm also, only the sexual organs are working in separate part. That is in the unconscious level. But when the conscious level comes, and when we try to contract the pelvic diaphragm, the whole muscle gets contracted. So, because area in the brain is associated with the perineum. The area in the brain associated with the perineum, that is more important, because we are looking at the pudendal nerve and we are thinking only the pudendal nerve stimulates. But this excretory organs, this urinary area, and the moolabandha area, they are all represented in the brain in a different area. So when the brain acts, it acts through that area and it stimulates the parts separately. So the pelvic muscles are mainly required for all the subconscious and unconscious autonomic activity. The lack of conscious nervous control makes it difficult for a person to both urinate and defecate at the same time. That's why we are not able to contract the perineum and the conscious level. So it is difficult to perform Vajroli Asuri Mudras without performing Mula Bandha at the same time. This is equal for both the men and women. So here we should understand what is the perineal body. Now we have seen the perineum and now we have come to the perineal body. There exists a clear distinction between the perineum and the perineal body or the central tendon. Here you can see that yellow area. This area, I think. So that area represents the perineal body. In the male and female, the perineal body is a small fibromuscular node, about 1 to 1.5 inches in front of the anus and approximately 2 inches inside the body. That's more important. When we are talking about the carmium, we always tell it is between the eruvi and caruvi midpoint and 2 inches above. So anatomically, that corresponds to this perineal body. And what if you see the picture also, all the muscles are converging towards that. This is at the physical level. So astral level also, I feel the nadis are converging only towards this point. This is the point we call as Mooladhara. So again, the perineal body. The perineal body in the male and female, the position, the name little bit changes. The actual point of physical contraction varies according to the sex. In the male, it is the perineal body. It is outside. But in the female, it is the area around the cervix. It is little bit up. Here I have shown the arrow. The below this area is the perineal body and the arrow looks at the cervix. Below also I have shown on a blue line. The upper one is the cervix and the lower one is the corresponding area of the perineal body. So when in the ladies we contract, the contraction will be felt only at the in the vaginal canal and in the cervix. So when we are doing Mula Bandha, for the man, if you touch in the center of the perineum, you can see the contraction. But in the female, you have to keep your finger in the vaginal canal and you should touch the cervix. There we can feel the movement of the cervix and movement of the labia minora and majora. So that is the importance of the perineal body. That position little bit varies from male and female, but both are anatomically and physiologically same. So as we said, now we can see the red point is the Mula Bandham in male. And in the male of female body, you can see the red point is placed a bit up, but they are in the same plane. And Asuri Mudra is the blue dot, right? So the perineum and the perineal body. Towards this point of perineal body, pelvic muscles converge and are attached. They are the superficial and deep transverse perineal muscles, bulbous spongiosus, the external anal sphincter, and the levator ani muscle. The rectum also sends some of its muscle fibers to the central and vitally important structure which divides the urogenital area from the anal region. So according to this, so many muscles and tendons and fibers are there. All are converging towards the perineal body. That is why we are giving more importance to the perineal body in the physical body. Astral body, we are talking it as Mooladhara and nadis, 72,000 nadis. So if we see, if you do Vajroli Mudra, Asuri Mudra, Mooladhara, they are performed here. The anal area including all the muscles. Their actual locations of these muscles can best be described by personal experience. This is what I said. When we do Mulabandha in male, when we touch the central part of the perineum, we can see the contraction. And when we, for female, when we put in the finger into the vaginal canal, we can see the contraction. So whenever you have to consciously withhold the onset of urination or defecation, you became actually aware of the muscles necessary for both Vajroli Mudra and Ashwini Mudra. So we have to keep our attention over the levator and the muscles. And when we are doing Mulabandha, we should be aware of that contraction of the levator or the muscles. Then only we can appreciate the Vajroli Mudra and Ashwini Mudra. So it is in the conscious level, it is difficult to release both those muscles at the same time. But when the excretion is concluded, both Vajroli and Ashwini again spontaneously occur at shorter time. But this also in not in our conscious level, unconsciously, when the process is over, both are happening together at the end. This we are experiencing it, but we are not realizing this. So the urogenital muscles, including transverse perineal superficialis, all the muscles, in the male, when they are contracting, the penis is slightly contracted inwards. In the female, the clitoris, lower vaginal muscles, and urethra are getting contracted. So here again, I have shown the Ashwini Mudra, the lower end of the anal canal, and I have shown the picture of the Ashwini Mudra on the right side. On the left side, I have shown what is Vajroli Mudra, what number 2 is the Mulabandha, number 3 is the Ashwini Mudra. Now let us go for the neurological and endocrinological aspect. This Mulabandha really integrates the neurological, endocrine, and endocrinology functions by manipulation of the body energies. The nervous system is coordinated with the endocrine system by way of central midbrain structure, the limbic system. Within this lies the hypothalamus, which controls the autonomic components of the nervous system as well as the endocrine glands. So, when the nervous systems are activated, they produce immediate effect. But when they stimulate the endocrine systems, they do not produce immediate effect. It takes some time. That is why when we practice these bandhas, we cannot get benefits immediately. If you go on do these bandhas for at least 6 months, then only we can get the benefits, or we can realize and we can feel the benefits. So now we are seeing, we know the central nervous system. It has got the spinal cord and the brain. It regulates the body, the autonomic nervous system. Autonomic nervous system usually not under our consciousness, but through yoga and by this Mulabandha practice, with the consciousness on the Mulabandha, we can bring that action of autonomic nervous system at least to a certain extent into the conscious level. And sympathetic nerve, when this comes into action only when there is a stress, tension, or emotions. Usually, this is in a subtle way, and this works in a recessive way. The dominant factor is the parasympathetic system. This parasympathetic system, when we contract the levator and the muscles of the pelvic floor, it not only it contracts, it stimulates the sacral nerve. So the parasympathetic systems are dominant, and they act and they give the deep sense of rest and relaxation in the body and mind. Again, and when we come to the parasympathetic mind action, we are getting that rest, relaxation of the mind. The emotional aspect disappears. And here again, now only I want to show why Ashwini Mudra and Vajroli Mudra, when they act in the unconscious level, it acts separately. But when we are acting consciously, why we are not able to control them? because it's a neurological process, but it is a mental response for the contraction of the various muscles. It is generated from a different area of the brain's cortex or the outer layer. In the nature, this is not our and our control, and it is in the subconscious level. That is why here we have to make the difference. Though the pudendal nerve, when we contract, the pelvic diaphragm contracts, but in the conscious astral body, the brain operates and it controls the Aswini Mudra and Vajroli Mudra. So it is important to realize that there is a difference between unconscious involuntary process involved in urination and defecation and conscious contraction as experienced in yogic practice. In the first case, the neuronal circuits related to the perineal area are usually outside the normal range of conscious awareness. So through Moolabandha, we can learn to use those same as neuronal circuits as part of an act of our will. So with the range of conscious awareness. So this gives a control over them. So this is the hypothalamus. This picture just I wanted to show. See, we are reading only hypothalamus, hypothalamus. But within the hypothalamus, you see so many nucleus are there. We are thinking it's as a single unit. But it, for the anatomical dissection itself, it is available so many. But in subtle level, if you go, it must be lakhs and lakhs of impulses must be starting from this hypothalamus area. The CRH is secreted. That goes and stimulates the pituitary, and pituitary gives the ACTH hormone. So this is the hypothalamo adrenal cortex, hypothalamo pituitary adrenal cortex axis. CRH to pituitary, pituitary with the ACTH stimulates the adrenal cortex, and adrenal cortex releases the cortisol. When the cortisol released enough amount, then it gives the negative feedback mechanism and blocks the pituitary and hypothalamus. This is the negative feedback mechanism. So use the Moolabandha is not a physical technique. We should understand it is a pranic technique. Then only we can have the awareness on the Moolabandha. So we should have the awareness on the Moolabandha chakra in the perineum, where we focus and concentrate our energies in the attempt to contract the hitherto unknown and hidden areas of the body that we have never isolated and contracted before. So with the awareness, the Moolabandha acts in the pranic, and if you realize and if you continue, lot of things will be coming into the awareness of our mind. So the pranic energy. So though it appears to be a simple muscular contraction, the real work is psychic energy. As the energies are stimulated there, we become conscious of this area. We become aware of the chakra and the psychic components and nadis, etc. In time, with the persistent practice, we can refine our energy and convert it into a highly concentrated force. It will be like a laser, which is converted from an ordinary light, but it's a powerful source. Like that, that ordinary energy can be converted into a powerful energy. So the pranic energy in Mooladhara Chakra has been refined like this. It is the dormant potential energy is released in Moolabandha. The process builds on itself, snowballing into a virtuous cycle of ever-increasing health, awareness, and bliss. So with the Moolabandha itself, we are getting this awareness and bliss. The full impact of the Moolabandha is now exported by the fact that it is not only the peripheral body, it is also the 72,000 nadis from which it is the source also stimulated. So nadis also getting stimulated. So the hitherto dormant areas of the brain begin to plug into conscious awareness. So increasing our ability to live a life fully. When prana is increased, more and more of the brain is available for our conscious control. Brain comes into our conscious control. So here, when it is awakened fully, the sleep in Kundalini is awakened. The last topic is the Mula therapy. Yes, you see, this technique produces a beautiful energy and it relaxes the body. So when there is a depression or imbalance in the chronic body, imbalance in the mental body, this relaxation technique helps to release that psychological problem. But here there should be one caution, because as a doctor I have to tell, only to certain level this will happen. But when the problem is very severe, it should be controlled along with that. Other techniques also should be used to control. So this Bandha should be used along with the medical therapy also used. So each one can complement and we can easily control the disease. So at the physical level, what are all the diseases controlled? Everybody knows. Whatever the disease in the anal canal, the piles, constipation, anal fissures, ulcers, and in the prostate, all will be relieved. The effect spreads through the endocrine system and it may help in the asthma, bronchitis, arthritis, and so on. These are all remote from the anal area, but still because of the endocrine stimulation, the remote area also getting relieved, get some benefits. So the medical benefits in the female. In the female, during pregnancy, when they do this Mula Bandha and Ashwini Mudra, it maintains the elasticity of the vaginal walls and aiding a painless delivery. And it, to a certain extent, it avoids the cesarean section also. So after delivery also, if they continue this exercise Bandha, this will assist in retoning muscles stretched during pregnancy. So other more than this, it's helpful for the prolapse of the uterus, leukorrhea, etc. in the woman. In the male, it alleviates the spermatoria. It helps to a certain extent in the inguinal hernia, controls the testosterone secretion and the sperm formation. Again, we are coming back to the ladies and what happens in the menopause stage. In the menopause stage, both men and women are getting the menopausal stage, but men are not realizing the transition period, but women are realizing the transition period and psychologically they are getting affected. By doing this Mula Bandha, that psychological effect can be removed and they can live as a normal woman as they are in the premenopausal stage. Next. The endocrine system, it because this Mula Bandha stimulates the gonads in both sexes and that produces an energy. That energy is called ojas. And here only the Vajrayoni Mudra help comes in, because Mula Bandha may lead to an increased sexual energy. When the energy is increased, it has to be sent out. It has to be excreted out. That is the rule. But if you practice the Vajrayoni Mudra, it redirects the energy upwards. It dissipation of the sexual energy takes place and helps for the sublimation for a higher purpose. The energy is recycled and sent back and will be used for a higher purpose. So in the sexual aspects, it helps for the sexual control, helps for the brahmacharya. For both the scientific and spiritual view, Mula Bandha does not cause loss of sexual virility. Because when we control the sexual point, people may think the virility may go down. No, the virility never goes down. It only allows the sexual energy either to go up for the spiritual development or it directs it downwards for the marital relationship. In this way, when we are doing this Mula Bandha and all, and when we control our sexual energy, sometimes people may get guilt feeling and frustration. So this wrong notions can be removed by this Mula Bandha. So again, if you see that ojas, that energy, it's a immense sexual energy. It's a positive means of expression. And it's a, when we perform Vajroli Mudra, it can be used in a different way. How, in what are the ways? In one way is when the redirected energy can be used for working, painting, writing, inventing, and so on. Whatever be the avenue of expression, the vital energy or ojas should not be lost or wasted in the ideal sensual enjoyment. Unnecessarily, we should not lose the ojas energy. Ultimately, ojas is the majestic unfoldment of the mostly highly refined consciousness. Whether it reaches the final culmination in the Sahasrara or remains bounded by the walls of the Mooladhara is a decision that exemplifies the turning point to the spiritual life. So again, the same thing. The householder achieves union through the framework of the marriage. The renunciate sublimates the sexual energy to achieve inner union. Others find this expression through working, painting, writing, inventing, and so on. However, the goal is the same. That is the transcendental union of the consciousness and the energy.
Wow.
So again, I am telling, for the householder, in order to solve the sexual problems and enhance, maintain, and sustain a healthy sexual relationship, helps it helps for the renunciate to sublimate the energy of overt sexual expression into the awakening of the higher centers. Then the other part is the relaxation part. When it relaxes, it releases the mental, unwanted mental things as a purgatives and gives the relaxation. So it is used in the various personalities like phobia, mania, hysteria, depression, and anxiety. Next comes one word called abreaction. Although the Moolabandha is effective as a relaxation therapy technique, it has been already described primarily a physical practice. The physical contraction is merely a means to locate a psychic body component. But then the real work starts, the unconscious mind is stimulated. So in Moolabandha, because of that pranic energy, we are able to stimulate the unconscious mind. So the suppressed mental energy is allowed to surface into the conscious awareness. That is, the release of emotional energy is called abraction. Through Moolabandha, this energy makes us to release the emotional energy out. That remembering the past dramas, memories was useless in the psychotherapeutic process. But releasing emotional energy is very important. This requires one to consciously relieve the experience, thereby freeing one from dissipated, functional, and non-disintegrated energy. This disintegrated energy in the subconscious mind is released to the conscious mind. So when it is relieved, the patient will be in a terrifying act or anxiety because of this provocation. See that picture. The patient will be in this stage when they are released. So a lot of psychological disturbances and even breakdown will take place at this level. The same reaction what we are doing through Moolabandha can be done by the psychiatrist by drugging the patient. By drugging the patient, what we are doing is, again, we are relaxing the mind and we are opening the unconscious mind and the unconscious mind to act, and all the suppressed reactions will be released. So finally, what we are coming to the point is, our brains are having fixed patterns and predetermined ways that they interfere in a good or bad way in lot of ways. But through this bandhas and meditation, we can reset the brain, increase our circle of awareness, and we can produce a recognition patterns of our neurotic patterns. So we can reset our brain. So conclusion is, through this bandha, our animal characters will be removed, intuition and control and selflessness improves, peace, divinity prevails, and it helps for the union of consciousness and prana. It is like a diamond shining with its own inner light. This is the potential that awaits us in Mooladhara Chakra in the form of Kundalini Shakti. Then, thank you, sir.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you very much, doctor. It was so nice. It was raining outside or inside. Let us hear from Dr. Ravindranath ji. Please unmute yourself and come.
Yes, sir. Unmuted.
Dr. Swatantra Devi to give her comments.
Excellent speech and presentation, and I can appreciate how much of effort has gone into this making of the and we would really like to know, doctor, from what are the sources you have taken all this. I know there are parts of Bihar school also, but there are so many other schools of thoughts also you brought in. And I think we have nothing to say more than that, because what we've been discussing in this group about the perineal nerve, parasympathetic activity, the neuroendocrines, and all those things, you have combined everything and put it in a nutshell, and you have not left out anything. So that is one thing I want to say. And you touched upon some very fine points. So today, actually, I was thinking when Dr. Rabindranath asked me to talk about something, I was thinking about the perineal body, because nobody gives importance to the perineal body. And that is the most important thing, you know, about this Ashwini Mudra and Moolabandha, to understand the perineal body. You have put out many slides where you have focused on the perineal body. Maybe when you give it in direct classes, you can concentrate, you can zoom it and show the area a little more. And as you said correctly, it's a fibromuscular body, which everybody can feel on their own cells, especially the men. You can feel it as a nodule and a thickening in the area. And exactly it corresponds to what our Siddha said. Eruvaiki iruviral mele, karuvaiki iruviral kile. So they have said it long, thousands of years back, they have said the thing. But you correctly pointed out that it is only on the physical plane. So it is the external indication of what is inside, or the psychic level. So that, but that place is the place you have to concentrate so that you can access the Mooladhara on the psychic level. Just like the endocrine glands are the on the physical plane, where the chakras are on the psychic plane or the astral plane. So just like that, this is the representative body. The perineal body is the representative of Mooladhara or the Karumayam, what Swamiji has been repeatedly saying, the Karumayam, that this is the, you have to concentrate on the perineal body. That is why I went on saying, the anal contraction is not enough, the contraction of the levator ana or the perineal body is more important. So thank you for that. And then the contraction of, you said the three different areas, Vajroli, Moolabandha and Ashwini Mudra. Those three are, you can't do separately. It's difficult. Yes, it is difficult, but it is possible. And of course, we have gone through the same class. I told Dr. Rabindranath also. But as you go through it, it becomes very easy. As the muscles develop and you get a conscious control, that is that becomes possible. So that is one thing. And the other thing is, you said it's a pranic technique. Yes, very correct. everything in yoga is on the pranic body. So we do asanas also on the physical level, but it has an effect on the pranic level and the psychic level. So that is why yoga becomes more powerful than all the exercises and things like that. So you said this Moola Bandha is also a pranic technique and not just a contraction of the muscle. I really appreciate you for saying that. And of course, the strength, the physical benefits are really, for all the people, it's really good. Because from the beginning, if you do, in ladies, the main problem is stress incontinence, which comes later on in life. And after that, it doesn't improve so much. But keep doing all these bandhas from the beginning and immediately after delivery, this problem of stress incontinence can be really solved. And prolapse uterus also. But ladies don't come up. So we can take one of the postgraduate students can take that itself as a PG, their subject. And of course, about the Ojas energy, we already saw that. And this energy is only a sublimation of the seventh dhatu, that is the seminal fluid. So the seventh dhatu is sublimated. Or refined, and the Ayurveda says the eighth dhatu. So it becomes an energy. From the physical nature, it becomes energy, and that energy, when it goes up through the central nervous system or the sushumna, it opens up the brain cells. And we know that we use only about 5%, not even 5% of the brain cell. But this energy, as it goes up every day, it opens newer cells. So you develop more psychic abilities like telepathy, telecommunication, clairvoyance, clairaudience, all those things. And these are exactly what the Siddhas called as Siddhis. And only those who have got this Ashtama Siddhis, they became Siddhas. And they got these Siddhis because they opened up all their brain cells. So they could do anything. So that is one thing important. And the basic and the beginning is Moola Bandha, Ashwini Mudra and Moola Bandha. So that is also a very good point you said. And the Abhri action was a very eye-opening thing. How from the physical, you can also handle the psychic problems and relieve the psychic problems by the physical methods. So it should be, that is also one research-oriented point. So really, thank you very much, sir. And it was a really, really very good presentation. And we appreciate you very much for that.
Thank you, Dr. Sundaraji. I think next week there will not be any review from me. You have already reviewed it. Thank you very much.
No, but still we'll forget in 1 week. You always give a concise thing. It's a good revision class you're giving us.
And it is a good record which you are creating.
Okay, now, Doctor,
I will ask Mahabali Rajan.
Mahabali Rajan, please unmute yourself and come.
Today I've seen a very wonderful presentation. It covers as Madam talked about, like it covers everything. And in fact, from spiritual point of view, medical point of view, so it's a kind of explanation for many, many unanswered questions we had today. I mean, so far we had a lot of questions in our mind. But a single presentation tried to explain many, many answers for us. So very nice presentation. Thank you, sir. I mean, I also learned a lot from this presentation. I mean, because when I hear the presentation, some of the spiritual and the religious things came to my mind. For example, the people talked about why Lord Sivalinga and given that appearance, like one round like structure and the cone like structure is exactly maybe talking about the perineal structure, what kind of. And also in the Jesus, there is a very hot topic like Holy Grail. So that came to my mind when Sar was talking about the area around the cervix kind of thing. So the Holy Grail ends up with like the women womb kind of thing. So that is also exactly the same point. I mean, would not know exactly, but I was remembering what exactly. So that perennial body may be having a wonderful kind of system. And so here I want to, I mean, because it's a mixed audience. So, I mean, ma'am also was talking about all the times like parasympathetic nervous system kind of thing. But I mean, I used to talk, like I used to take lectures in the central nervous system. There, I think I give, I think many of you may not understand. So like, why it is called sympathetic nervous system kind of thing. So it's a very interesting, like why it is called sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. So many people know that when we are under stress, the sympathetic nervous system is activated and parasympathetic nervous system, like it bring back to our normal condition. So many people may not aware that why it is called the sympathetic nervous system. So I think I'll tell that why it is, because when you see in the, I think if you allow me, I'll give a brief. So in sympathetic nervous system, what are the things happening? And exactly opposite things happening in the parasympathetic nervous system. So because I was telling about the central nervous system and everything. So if you allow me, I'll give a single slide, then we can understand what sympathetic nervous system. And in fact, so you can understand that each and everything that is happening in the sympathetic nervous system is a kind of, it helps us to survive in that dangerous moment. That's what is called the fight or flight response. So I think, let me see, can I have
this? Yeah, go ahead. Show the slide, please.
Yes, yes.
Share the screen.
Make him co-host, sir.
Oh, okay. I could not share.
Yes. Now you can share.
So now you can see the slide, sir?
Yeah, we can see that.
Yeah. So here, I think sir was talking about cortisol. So one side is cortisol. When you see the cortisol, maybe you can see. There are two kinds of pathway. One is like short-term stress, meaning it's like an acute stress. In case of acute stress, especially suppose if a person is seeing the snake, or a person is confronting a person who's having the gun in their hands. So that time is like acute stress. So that time the body initiates the mechanism is called fight or flight response. That means either we need to get away from the place or we need to fight with that person. So that need a lot of energy. Okay. And basically this sympathetic nervous system, it seems that why it is called sympathetic nervous system, for example, if you see this slide, so you see, basically you can see this one. When there is a sympathetic nervous system activation, ultimately your skeletal muscle get a lot of energy. Okay. That's why you can see that the blood flow to the skeletal muscle increases. And that is a converging point from so many organs, starting from the brain, heart, lung, stomach, everything coordinating together such a way that blood flow to the skeletal muscle increases so that the person should run away from that place or fighting with that kind of. So in that case, basically why it is called sympathetic nervous system means our body is having sympathy on us so that it gives a lot of energy in a short-term basis. In a very small time, it gives a lot of energy so that we run away from this place. If the body does not have a sympathy, then we may die because of the gun shooting or the snake biting or everything. So in this, you can see that the heart rate increases. That means it pumps more blood. And the blood sugar level increase by converting glycogen into the glucose. Because not only the pumping blood is not sufficient, the blood should contain sugar. Then only it will be converted into energy kind of thing. And the people dilate. That means we are looking all around the place, where is the place to escape kind of. And similarly, breathing rate increases because when the blood flow is going to the skeletal muscle, but the blood flow should contain the sugar as well as the oxygen. So everything is like, now you can understand that, why it is called sympathetic nervous system, because it is having sympathy on us so that we can survive. On the other hand, exactly everything is going opposite way in the parasympathetic nervous system. Now we need to see that, you can see that the heart rate decreases, lung breathing decreases. Ultimately, so this is the thing I want to say, that there may be a connection between a kind of perineal body and this, the madam was talking about like parasympathetic nervous system kind of thing. So now I think we need to see like, we need to see what kind of mechanism. So what kind of parameters can be measured that can measure actually we are meditating kind of thing. So this is a wonderful presentation, sir. Thank you very much. I just want to add this comment, because when you are hearing about this autonomic nervous system, I want to add some more points on this. Wonderful.
Very nice. Now you have seen the pelvic floor and you have seen the brain also. Now the Maharishi's problem was how to lift that energy in the pelvis into the brain. And this upward thrust is given by how? This is given by the physical body. The physical body creates a negative pressure in the chest area. This negative pressure sucks the energy prepared in the pelvis. For this only, we do the folding of the tongue back, the Keshari Mudra, and also the Jalandhara Bandhana. It doesn't manifest fully in this. And Uddiyana Bandhana, we are not utilizing it in this thing. So to say whether it is a Mahabandha is a debatable point. Here, the teachers who taught me the Kayakalpa, they used to say that there should be no penile movement of the penis or the testicular movements should not be there with Ashwini Mudra. And now we are telling it is, though called Ashwini Mudra, it is a perineal body mudra or the vaginal contraction mudra. This is exactly for a layman. This is totally different from what Swamiji has said. We have references with the Siddha's literature that the perineal genetic center is located only just above the perineal body at the level of the cervix, and in the male it is only just 2 inches above the perineal body. So to translate this expression to the common aspirant in the WCSC, it is a major problem. That is, we are telling something against what Swamiji has said. So, but we are not telling it without a basis. Now we have to find ways how to explain and translate. And for this, I suggest people to do the Kayakalpa, the Ashwini Mudra, with the perineal body centric Ashwini Mudras. If we perform perineal body centric Ashwini Mudras, there will be the excursion of the perineal body up and down. And this, if they are doing it clearly, Dr. Devi said, we can do the anal contraction separately, vaginal contraction separately, and the urethral contraction separately. And we can do all the three together also. So here, a practice of contracting only the real Ashwini Mudra, that is the vaginal contraction or the contraction of the cervix there, and this thing. So when we talk about these differences, we we need to have some evidences for what we say. That comes from a study of comparative study of the regular way of doing the Ashwini Mudra and the informed way of doing Ashwini Mudra, scientific Ashwini Mudra. So these two are acting differently, and what effect it has in practice, we have to see. And the energy lifted from the pelvis to the skull, to the brain, is more by the physical body, I said. So by giving a Moola Bandha, you are preventing the energy from passing downwards, and it gives a thrust upwards. The energy is given a thrust. The pressure at the perineal level is higher because of the pelvic contraction, Ashwini Mudra Moola Bandha, it is high. And you are creating a negative pressure in the chest with the holding up of the tongue backwards, Keshari Mudra. The nasopharynx is obstructed, and the oropharynx is, we close the mouth. And with the obstructed nose, you create an inspiratory effort. The inspiratory effort against a closed nasopharynx and closed mouth prevents air entry inside. But the act of taking a breath in, inspiratory chest expansion, this creates a negative pressure in the, this thing. And just like a ink filler, the bladder when compressed and released with the tip inside the ink level, then it absorbs it, sucks in. So similar suction force is generated, and here you are performing it in the physical body, and the impact is on the astral and the causal body, and the magnetic is energy is more lighter and sensitive, and so that preferentially moves ahead of the rest of the energies. So here the important point is the participation of the mind element. The mentally you lift the energy from the Mooladhar to the Sahasradhar, to the top, by the mental command. The energy is coming up along with the breath. So this part is very vital to complete the process. So this is how the energy moves. But if you have the Uddiyana Bandha and the Jalandhara Bandha, the practice, the passage of the pressure difference and the suction of the energy and its passage to the brain may be getting affected. So this point needs clarification, and before we give it to others. And as an experiment, which is right, which is very vital, contracting the anus or the contracting the perineal contraction focused at the perineal body. So people who can do the perineal body Ashwini Mudra can practice it for some time and study, subject it to the studies as we did in mitochondrial study. So the blood samples may be taken, and mitochondrial gene expression and the other parameters studied in the experiment can be reproduced, subjected to the results, can be subjected to that analysis, which will show, if it shows the perineal body Ashwini Mudra gives better results, then it is easy for us to take it across the general practitioners or the non-medical professors and scholars to accept it. So that is a vital point. You have taken the entire pelvic floor movement, not the selective movement in Kayakalpa. So the Vajroli part is discouraged, and the anal contraction is the one which can be explained easily to a beginner, not the vaginal contraction, especially when he happens to be a male. And Kayakalpa has the unanswered questions pertaining to male and the female. And we have the semen in the male, and what is the equivalent to it in the female? It is a question which is remaining for the past, say, 70 years to my knowledge. And the ovum is released once a month. The sperms are available all the time. So if there is any basis to say the gametes, the sperm and the ovum, are the real players in Kayakalpa, that may not be right. It is only the vital energy. The sexual vital fluid has the energy component. I say that it is an abstract fluid. It is neither gas nor liquid nor solid. So it is combining all the three. Maharishi gives the word fluid, sexual vital fluid. And how this practice of manipulating the sexual vital fluid lifts the individual's orientation to spirituality for higher areas of planes of operation. Here, the body, total body energy dynamics. When the vital fluid, sexual vital fluid accumulation exceeds a critical value in the genetic center, it gets ejaculated with or without your consent or effort. So, which results in loss of vital fluid. So, when this is lost regularly, then the higher possibilities in a person's life is almost not available for the common man to experience. And for this, we are lifting, converting the vital fluid into ojas energy and utilizing it. And this we are doing almost 6 to 8 times a day to a number of 13 to 14 Kayakalpas. So the purpose of spacing the Kayakalpa practice in the morning, evening, midday, night, like that, is only to steal the energy at the pelvic level to the cranium, to the brain, so that it is never overflows. The energy at the pelvis never overflows. These explanations, how we give in a lady, we people have to contemplate on that, to give that answer and its importance of protecting ones, guarding one, putting a control over the sexual indulgence or orientation in our day-to-day life. So when the accumulation in the pelvic floor of the vital fluid is not beyond the critical value, then there is a suppression of the, or the sexual thoughts doesn't arise, which also has to be studied with the individuals, Sky practitioners. And the overall activity in psychology, Dr. Shanmugavel can say that the sexual arousal in the human being is a cyclic, is this cyclic nature is related to the amount of our sexual vital fluid that is getting accumulated in the genetic center area, in the center of the listening. And yet another point which we have not covered is the churning movement created by the Ashwini Mudra. A spinning system created by the Ashwini Mudra. How the spin takes place? It is because of the nature of the contraction. So this has to be proved experimentally. Then only the separation of the pelvic contents takes place, solid, liquid, gaseous, and the fatty layer, superficial layer. Above that is the energy layer. So all these layers can be, after performing the Ashwini Mudra, if we have a method to identify all these solid, liquid, gaseous, and the energy level, that will be very helpful. That is another area which we have to concentrate and work out for a project. So with these things, I think the presentation opens our mind to various other possibilities, and also creates a concern whether we are confining ourselves to Maharishi's teachings or exceeding the limits like that. And Dr. Devi also suggested that a comparative, where all you have collected these information, the source for your presentation, for your ideas, supported by what? So these things will also be helpful. And some of the Udyana Bandha and the Mahabandha part of it, we have to see again, discuss it. I think we can do it individually. So with this, I think I will conclude my speech and ask the junior active members to raise their questions or give their views.
Thank you, Doctor. I think some of the new scholars who have come, what is their experience on today's proceedings? Shanti, can you come out?
Sir, I want to tell the books which I referred.
Oh,
yes,
sure.
Yes, please.
Yeah. That will be a very huge list.
The lot of lists are there. Finally, Google this Moolabandha block, then Kundalini Yoga by Sivananda Saraswati Swami.
That of course we have got. The other one is not there. Yeah. Okay, thank you. Other than that, your collection from the Google University is
Google
too
is more.
Many. I always been telling, you know, day and night he collects. Actually, you should know, Shanti, how to search. It's not just 1 or 2 hours. for this preparation itself, you know, 1 week is not sufficient. Because of his earlier collection, he could get so much data to us. Very nice, doctor. Okay. Yes,
only, Shanti. Only some time before, I was telling Shanmugavir that the collection process, if you try by yourself, it is very difficult and you may not be successful. But if you combine, right, take the help of Maharishi, he will give, yes, you what all points, right, you require. The exact page and the diagram you want, he will give it to you.
Yes, sir. This, yes, I realized, yes, so many times.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
I,
yeah,
was wondering how I got this.
Deep meditation. Okay, thank you. Yeah, we are running out of time. So, Shanti, you got 1 or 2 minutes, quick.
Yes, I have a moment, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
It's really an eye-opener for us. We are all precious to this kayakalpa, although we have been practicing it for years. But the anatomical and physiological functions we learned in this session, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Give me a lot of information and adding to your presentation. I'd like to show my slides on Yoga Upanishad because it will add an evidence to you. Can I do it, sir? Can I share the screen?
Not now. Not now, ma. We will do it again.
Okay.
It's already 10:10. Anyway, I appreciate your.
Yeah, yeah, very happy readiness, you got also.
Readiness to share your treasure.
Yes. There is evidence in Yoga Upanishads, sir. Yes,
thank you.
There is evidence in Yoga Upanishads. Okay.
Very
nice. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to join you.
Yes, yes. Scholar Hema Malini.
Thank you so much, doctors. Really, what Shanti has told, it's a great eye-opener for all new scholars, sir.
Okay.
Thank you for making us to understand the importance and the practice. So we'll be volunteering for your research work, sir. You told we need some people to practice it.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you.
So we will volunteer for that, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, you're now, welcome.
Thank you so much, doctor.
Anuradha.
Thank you, doctor.
K. Anuradha. Yes.
Arshavalamudan, sir. So really, it was a very nice presentation. Actually, the same doubt I had in Kayakalpa, how the Jalandhra Bandha and Udyana Bandha is related, the same doubt I had. So you have cleared that. And another thing, we have studied about physical body, astral body, and causal body. So today, I have came across a new word, which is a perineal body. It's a different thing. So I understood that.
Sorry. It is not that body. It is just like a part of the body.
Yeah, part of the body. So yeah. I understood that this perineal body, which connects the physical body and the astral and causal body. Right. So is my understanding is correct?
Yes, correct.
You have to find out, substantiate, yes, with the other findings from your own search.
Okay.
It is a hypothetical expression. We have to find out whether it is real or not.
So I had many doubt. What is the difference between Ashwini Mudra and Mula Bandha? So today I got clarified. So the place, it seems that there is a place we can know about Ashwini Mudra and Mula Bandha. So I understood that today, sir. So long days, I had a doubt that what is the difference between that both.
You talk to Dr. Shanmugavir. He will explain to you. You need some more information on that.
Yes, sir. So, sir's slides made me clear. So, what is the difference?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Valka Valamudan, sir.
Samurai Selvi.
Yes, Valka Valamudan, doctor. And actually, it is good night. Going to be good night to all. Actually, I have two clarification which we. Somebody can clarify to next session. That is, I want to know about the normal level of, is there any level for ojas, and what happens if it depletes, because depletion factors I want to take into discussion, and the three doshas and this ojas, tejas and prana related discussions. I want to have further in further sessions, sir.
Just put it down and send it.
Yeah,
to
sure.
Right. Aruna.
Your session was very informative and excellent presentation. This was something new, and even I have never heard it today. Really, even my eyes opened as it was said by others. It was an eye-opening session. And yes, we need to look into how we can take these concepts into further research, and how from that research, how we can prove it. So we need to think how this can be done. And a kind request, if you could share the PPT, it will be very useful for us also in the future. It will be good if you could share the PPT to us also, sir.
Thank you.
Whoever wants it, you can ask Dr. Shanmugavel. He will be willing to give it.
I can share, no problem.
Yeah, it is after all what we have taken from others.
Yes.
So we can share. And now, who else is that? Dr. Dhanapati?
Unmute yourself. Valvalamudan, sir.
Valvalamudan.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, quite okay.
Thank you, Valvalamudan. Wonderful, excellent presentation. Enlightening presentation by our Shanmugavel Ayya. Ayya, thank you so much. It's very, very, very nice presentation. Actually, you try to connect the physical movements with physiological aspects and then to psychological. I think it is very much necessary for forming a theory of Kayakalpa Yoga. I am not talking about what five philosophies what Maharishi has told. This is regarding to do any research, there is a need of theory of Kayakalpa Yoga. For that, we need to connect the dots. We talk about that there are a lot of diseases cured by doing Kayakalpa Yoga. So we need to connect the disease, physiological changes and the physical movements. That's what I think. So
the physical results, which we
physical,
see.
Physical movements, what I talk about, physical movements by doing Ashwini Mudra Ojas. So physical movements of Ashwini Mudra, Moola Bandha and Ojas Breath, and which connecting these movements to the physiological changes. For example, our Ayya said that the parasympathetic nervous system is being activated. So this is the way we have to go forward. I am very happy that today's presentation is very much useful for creating a theory of Kayakalpa Yoga for a researcher. And I have one doubt. I request Ayya. Is it a hypothesis that by doing Ashwini Mudra, the parasympathetic nervous system is activated? Or is there any references or established facts are there? This is my doubt.
Authority, Dr. Devi will be able to answer it. She will do it in the next term.
If parasympathetic nervous system is activated, there will be a psychological changes. I think it has been established by the scientific community. But here what I look for is that is there any established fact to connect or any scientific research done earlier when we do Ashwini Mudra or whatever may be the Mudra, Mahabandha, Bandha, all these things to connect the parasympathetic nervous system? I think there was a research by from DRDO, I think Dr. Rabindranath knows very well, in which they have found that psychological changes are much effective by
doing in our own study.
So, but they have failed. Cannot say failed. They have not got impressive result in physiological changes. Maybe they have taken some other parameters to find out. But to connecting these mudras or bandhas to parasympathetic nervous system will be a better one. So it is a very good presentation, sir. Thank you so much. I have this doubt. Is there any established fact? If it is so, kindly.
You please you please write it to write and message it to Rangaswamy.
Yeah, next, Dr. Parameswaran would like to come for a few minutes. Parameswaran, you can unmute and come.
Sir, I wanted to share two things. One, when I was listening, it was just flashing to me. In AIIMS Delhi, for the MBBS syllabus, they identified some topics to be added as yoga, and they have made some syllabus and all. I was just thinking, why not we can approach maybe IMA or concerned authority that this is just 3 hours subject. So this can be part of every MBBS student all across India, maybe later world, that every doctor should learn this. Like if 100 doctors are learning, 10 people may be doing it seriously. That may be helpful for the entire community because they'll be reaching several hundreds, thousands of people. And that way, they can really do the research. Like it is not the medical scientist doing research with the laboratory pharmacological things. It is the research which needed to be done inner with the brain and our own metabolic, you know, functioning or psycho neurological whatever. And the modern science is still to reach the genetic center and such concept, which is very important. It is just 300, 400 years back, when they realized the importance of brain. Now it is very important to understand the importance of genetic center, which is the magnetic domain and which is the so-called soul or whatever. That needed to be understood very well so that the science of psychology can further elevate. That is one point. So the forum can look into this seriously and maybe look after some contacts, maybe with Indian Medical Association or whomsoever, to ensure that this kayakalpa is being given or added into part of the syllabus of all the MBBS student of different universities. That needed to be looked into seriously. Maybe we can make a proper syllabus accordingly. Second point is that there are so many schools of spiritual practices. I was going through, I could get a link of Google Drive where there are a good number of collections of books that are available related to Tao wisdom. And when I went through the materials, I could correlate that it is more related to the kayakalpa. And when Maharishi used to say that kayakalpa is the peak of Kundalini yoga, that needs more substantiated evidences and theory, as said by Dr. Dhanapathy. For formulating theory, we may require more and more inputs from different schools, basically. So the Ashwini Mudra is called by different terminology. For example, someone calls it as pelvic exercise, someone calls something else. So what exactly the term what we are using being used by different schools, it could be Buddhism or whatever. So I can share, if people are interested, the Google Drive link, in which even I could see there was a book which was related to some dark room technology, something wherein these serotonin, melatonin, all these secretion of such things and all were well discussed. So it may be good for us to make a theory. Such contributions from different schools could be helpful. Thank you.
Your suggestions are noted.
Right.
Next, agenda for the next.
Elamurugu Sekar is there from Middle East.
Yes, sir. Yes, Waldo, yes, sir. Madan, yeah, it is indeed. This is the very first maiden meeting I attended, but to be honest, I was completely overwhelmed with lot and lots of information, especially from the anatomy and the medical point of view, which were not aware, because I'm not from the medical background. But it arouses my interest to go deep into it, and probably in the future sessions I will be able to contribute, I presume. And with all your blessings and support, I'm sure we have to take this to the pinnacle. As Swamiji has said, this is the ultimatum in our forum, and I think we have to go deep into it and then take it to a very higher level, so that the whole world will be benefited as per the vision of Swamiji.
Okay.
Yes, Mr.
The next is giving the assignments to the scholars. I will do it individually and inform you the next meeting. So we can wind up the. Now we have to get the permission from Indraji.
Of course. Before that, you wanted to say agenda for the next meeting, Doctor.
Yeah. Agenda for the next meeting. Now, Shanmugavelu has given his presentation. Next week, I thought we will get an anatomy specialist and a physiology senior faculty.
Okay, you can announce
and,
later.
Talk on, yes.
And yeah.
Talk on the subject of pelvic floor, the anatomy and the significance, the physiology and its significance related to Kaikal.
Yes, now we'll go to US. Both of them are waiting to conclude. How is it, Dr. Indiraji and Guptaji?
First, let him go. About the session, what do you think?
Session?
No, this session.
Yeah, excellent. I really enjoyed and learned so much. So thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
Now, one more minute.
Yeah.
One more minute I will take. I will say I fully agree with Dr. Abhinath. In this session, on a scale of 1 to 10, it is 19. And one more thing I would like to share is we need a concerted document. As Dr. Dhanpati was saying, we need a theory that is all inclusive, and it gives us a roadmap to have consistent theoretical framework, practices, experience, and research. And we are moving towards that. It's beautiful. It's you know, very, very all inclusive. And so I think that going back to creating a document is a must. All people who are ready to share something so profound can be included in that document, and it can be put on the Google search, and it can have worldwide exposure. So that is one point. Same way, I have a question for Dr. Shanmugan Velu, that we have to include what all this exercising, the mental part, physical part, astral, causal, what it does to the quality and quantity of the sexual vital fluid. That needs to be included.
Yes, yes.
The most difficult part, since it is not available for studies.
Yes.
The concept is not absorbable, perceivable by many of the scholars, and it is not being abstract energy. It is not available for laboratory studies.
Okay. But it can be a hypothesis that
Do
all these things, it can open up for future generations to do research with the technology. How it impacts the quantity and quality of sexual vital fluid.
Yes, yes.
So that is my contribution. I really appreciate. And something that I have come across is there is a book that was written by some yogi or a researcher. His name is Abhinav Gupta. And Google has a lot of information about some of these things that we are discussing. So if you can find that book, I think it can enlighten us much more. So please search for it. But I am thoroughly happy. I'm thoroughly enlightened. And Dr. Rabindranath's work is like a genius. Thank you.
And it will be surely implemented in our next scientific conference. Not only a doctor conference, it will be done. And for that, this platform is available. And more youngsters should join and take care of this various topics. I think most of this is to Hosur to meet him. I am getting calls from Coimbatore. So I have not told him, but nevertheless, we will do so in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot to everybody. Dr. Ravindranaji, can we close it?
Please.
Thank you very much to all of you for the excellent contribution and all the newcomers. Wish you all the best. And you have a wonderful opportunity ahead. And please do your homework and come back with your questions. The more questions you ask, the more is the secrets will be revealed. Thank you very much. Good night. Be blessed by the divine.
Thyroid subject.
Indraji is hearing. This is a side talk, Indraji. Excuse us.
No. I want to be part of that.
Of course. It is a closed door secret meeting and you are admitted. Long distance passengers are most welcome.
Oh, thank you. No, but I think this is so really is the narrow down to kayakalp is the key. I mean, look at Swamiji gave the name Kayakalp Research Organization.
Sure, yeah. Yes. Why? You're very right. It is the foresight of founder father has really, kept a name like that. It was amazing. And that is what is being done. This is thanks to this Corona period and COVID period that this is, this subject is widely discussed by us. And the Consciousness 360, I think there are many of them are in the pipeline. There are more to come. So you will all get a lot of benefits. I think Muthumani sir is doing a tremendous amount of research at the background, behind the screen activities. And we want to thank Muthumani sir. You continue your efforts in searching and coordinating this with all of us. Thank you.
அழகடி சித்தர்னுடைய பாடல் அது வந்து அந்த ஓஜஸ் மூச்சை சொல்ற மாதிரியே இருக்குது. மூக்கால் அரும்பெடுத்து மூக்காய் தான் தூக்கி நாக்கால் வலை பரப்பி நார்ச்சதுர வீடு கட்டி நாக்கால் வலை பரப்பி நார்ச்சதுர வீட்டின் உள்ளே மூக்காலே காணாமல் தன்னம்மா முழுதும் தவிக்கலடி அப்படின்னு சொல்லி ஒரு அழகினி சித்தருடைய பாடல். இது வந்து ஓஜஸ்
அழகினி சித்தர அழகினி சித்தர அழுதுகிட்டே பாடி இருக்காரு. சரி அதை டிரான்ஸ்லேட் பண்ணி டாக்டர் இந்திராஜி வாண்ட்ஸ் டு நோ கேன் யூ டிரான்ஸ்லேட் தட் இன் இங்கிலீஷ்.
Thank you.
I will try and forward it.
முடிஞ்ச வரைக்கும் பாருங்க. கண்மவேலு சார் சொல்லுவாரு.
Next week I'll tell you. We can translate it.
சுதந்திரா
தேவியோட க்ளூ சார், அவங்க நிறைய சித்தர் பாட்டெல்லாம் பாடினாங்கல்ல, திருமூலர், மாங்காய் பயில், மாங்காய் பாலை தேங்காய் பாலாக்கி பிந்து பிந்துன்னு சொல்லிட்டு குதம்பை சித்தரை போட்டாங்க. அது ஸோ இவர் இன்னைக்கு இந்த ரிசர்ச்சில் வந்துட்டாரு. ஓகே, டெல் சம்திங் அபவுட் சம் ஃபியூ வேர்ட்ஸ் ஸோ தட் இன் இங்கிலீஷ் ஷி வில் அப்ரிஷியேட் திஸ் சித்தா ஃபிலாசபி.
நெக்ஸ்ட் வீக் பார்க்கலாம், 10:30
முடிஞ்ச வரைக்கும் பாருங்க. Then next time, oh,
next time.
He will study, you know.
Yes, yes.
Go, next week.
That's okay.
Yeah. He will come prepared. Off the cup, it's very difficult to give explanation for all the Siddha songs, but loaded with secrets. There is no doubt about it.
Okay.